parameters we have seen actually how to use this parameter. Of this parameter, that also we have seen. This overriding can be done using this module instantiation that we have here. That is, let me take this pen. This module instantiation override and use of def para. There are two methods. This is first method. This is the second method that we can use these two methods to override the parameters. Overriding the parameters. This method we have seen in the previous sessions. Today we will discuss this usage of this def para. So in this def para, we have this keyword. You see this keyword def para, and this instantiation name, you see this d0. This d0 is used here, and then there is a dot here. So let me take this color. This where this is the dot here. D0 dot, and then the parameter that we want to override, before underscore depth. This before underscore depth, if you see here, this one, before underscore depth. This is a leaf cell. This is a leaf cell or parameterized cell or a parameterized module. This entire one is a parameterized module or a generic module. In this generic module, we have FIFO underscore depth, this one. So this one we want to alter according to our requirement. So that module instantiation are by using this def param keyword. So if you use def param keyword, how do you do? This is how you do. You use first keyword, that is def param, and then space, and then you use the instantiation name. This d0, this is the instantiation name, and there is a dot here. You see the dot, and then the param that you want to alter, you want to override. And we want to override FIFO underscore depth and with a value 128. And then there is a syntax that needs to be followed, that is this semicolon. So that's how we override using this def param. So this is one approach that we can use anywhere to override the parameter. But the problems are, there are some problems associated with that. So those problems are, today we will discuss those problems with the help of this one paper. So parameter models is a paper that we have to, everyone, I'll share this one because I collected now everyone's attendees phone numbers. Possibly we will have form, otherwise in the common group I will post this one. Something I will do about this. But the point here is, Satish, can you, once this is visible?
Yes, sir, it is visible.
Okay. So now the point here is, let me take you screen markers out of this. These are really helpful for presenting. So if I take this, just 1 minute. This is not working or what? This is actually a screen highlighter or screen marker sort of application. I think I had to do without this. I'm not understanding the usage of this. I tried it offline, but now not. Okay, let us discuss. If you see this one, this parameter, there's a paper published by Clifford, this person. So they are the actually they run the company and they have several they teach, they train the people in the this domain, HDL domain. And they have published some paper, and I don't know in which year they published here, possibly in the 2002 they published. So what they said is, this is this backward define and depth of def param. You see this depth of def param. So they are talking about, you know, this by this time you must be aware of this about backward define. So backward define, I just brief about that. Elaborately we will take up later on, but for now you have something. This is backward. You write here define, and say there is a delay 1, and you start writing your module from here, and everything goes here, and you have here your end module. And in between, suppose say here somewhere you thought of having that this one, this one you want to have. So this is let us put instead of one, let us put some 10. So what you can is that macro. This is called macro. We call it as a macro. The macro. So we use here this macro name. Macro name here is a delay. Delay. Now I may have some assignment here. Assignment statement. Assign y a plus b. So a plus b. Now what is happening is, whenever I use, wherever in my entire code, wherever I use this macro, this delay macro, this is substituted. 10 is substituted there. The 10 is substituted. So that is happening with the help of define. Is a what it is. You must be remembering, everyone there. Backcode, the moment when you see the backcode, it is a compiler directive. Everyone must be aware about this. Wherever you see in the Verilog backcode, you see dollar, it is a system task or a system function. System task or a system function. You must be knowing what is the difference between system task and system function, and this compiler directive. Now the difference is here. If you have this backcode defined, then this macro is fixed. You cannot alter this, whatever the macro you are using, this delay and this 10, all that, and you cannot alter. There is no possibility of altering this override. Overriding is not possible. You cannot override this 10. So if you want to have facility by instantiating this leaf module, the module currently what you are writing here, module end module, elsewhere you want to instantiate and you want to alter the parameters, such values you want to alter, with the help of define you cannot do. You have to do with the parameter only. This is the parameter keyword only. You can have parameter and delay inside and then 10. Now elsewhere, if initially you can instantiate, and two methods that we earlier shown today also briefly shown, module instantiation method and def param method. With the help of those, we can override this delay only when if we use parameter. We use this backward define, that is compiler directive, you cannot override this delay. So that's the difference between this usage of this compiler directive and the parameter queue. Now the thing is, today's discussion, this def param is having some problems. This def param having some problems, some issues. Those issues are discussed. Those issues are discussed in this paper. This paper I will share, and you have to spend some time to study this one. So, but briefly, what I say is, for example, you have some parameter, this parameter, you have this module, so where some modules are discussed here. Module with four parameters. You see somewhere maybe parameter, this is T reset, T clock, size, version. Here are four parameters. And this, the syntax already we have discussed. If you want to go with only one parameter keyword, then you shouldn't be terminating with a semicolon here. You have to separate with a comma. The last one you have to separate with a, if you are planning to end this parameter usage, and then you have to terminate with a semicolon. So that's what exactly we are doing here. Now coming to this portion here, where one parameter, depth of this depth parameter, this section six, you have to spend some time and study why it is what problem dangerous of use of hierarchical depth param. Dangerous use of hierarchical depth param. So this depth param is having some problem anywhere in the module you can instantiate. For example, this is the module. You see this module, current module. Module and end module. Example 7. In this, what you are doing is depth param, this depth param you are using, and you are actually using this TD underscore dev param. TB underscore dev param is a instantiation name somewhere. So this somewhere where it is, we have to locate where it is, somewhere here it will be. You see this TB underscore dev param? This TB underscore dev param, this one, this module, somewhere we are instantiating. Actually, it's an instantiation name here, this one. If you see, let us go to our slide. This one. This slide. This one here, if you see what we are doing here is this D0 is actually is an instantiation name, and design underscore IP is actually a module name. This is some, these two are different. These two are different. One is instantiation name, and the other is a module itself, module name itself. And how do we override here? We are using def param keyword, and the usage is not a module, not a module. It's a module instantiation name. Module instantiation name in that module, in this particular module, that is, this is the name of the module, design underscore IP. There is a pipo underscore def is a parameter. This parameter we want to alter. So the basically what the point that I'm trying to make from this example is, with the usage I am trying to make here, we use a keyword and we use the instantiation name. So we have to locate where that instantiation name is, where that instantiation name is here in this TB underscore dev param here, where that instantiation name is, and dot size equal to 1. So that is the, what the work that you have to do once I share this document. You also can search on the internet, but I will share this one because you can avoid the internet searching time. So straight I say, share this one. So this TB underscore depth param, where it is that you have to locate. If you locate here somewhere size, this is a one module. This is one module. In this module, you are not instantiating. You are instantiating DF flip-flop, and the instantiation name is D1. And if you see this module, there is a TB underscore def param, and this has got size equal to 8. So this is exactly we are actually trying to address, that size we are trying to address. So by doing so, what we are messing up, everything is discussed here in this further depth of here from six onwards, everything is discussed. So what the summary of this paper is, if you use this def then you may mess up parameter overriding itself, because the power that it facilitates, hierarchical hierarchical module instantiation, that power that this def has got, that power using def to hierarchically change the parameters of module. This power who is having, this def param keyword is having, hierarchically it changes. You don't need to really in that those parameters that order here, this you know, this module instantiation override. What we are doing here, we put a the parameters that we want to alter and the value that we want to alter with. So the limit of the power of this module instantiation override is limited. The power is limited, but it is beyond this, the power of this def param is a beyond to this module, beyond to this current module. Being in any other module, you can override. How you can being in any other module? This is how you override. This is, you are there in some other module, and you are not using even instantiation name. You are using straight that module name itself, and you are this value itself you are altering. So by doing so, what happens is, if you don't really care, then by mistake, if you put something else here, this module name something else, accidentally if you put something, and if you the entire block is there, this is the complete top module, this is the entire your complete top module, and you have several such parameters to be altered here. You are instantiating this top module, you are trying to make some changes here. So these some changes, and unintentionally you have put something else here, some other module. So this entire parameter, the size now is changed to one now. So by doing so, some unintentional hardware will be developed. Unintentional hardware means garbage hardware will be developed, because the usage of different parameter is not really cared by the designer. This def param may lead to mishaps which are irreparable. If you big designs, if you take, if you use this, it is that will be irreparable. So that is what the problem with this def param, with this brief. Why I'm not going to take this entire thing is, the first point is, you take out time and you study. In case if you are not understanding, you put on WhatsApp, follow this defined parameter, you present with the examples. Definitely I will take up at that point, I will present with examples this def param problem, the problems with def param. So that's why I am, what my plan is, not to take up this one for making you people to understand. Rather, you people will understand through this document. You just go through, this is some 10 pages document, you kindly go through. This is very, very easy to understand. In case if you are not understanding, ping me on WhatsApp. I will present one class for this def param. So with this, let us proceed to next topic. This one I will share with you people. Let me just a moment. So hopefully everybody will focus on this document, shared document, and hopefully everybody will work about that, what hazards we have with that. So in case if you are finding difficulty, hopefully everybody will communicate to me so that I can present about that, what hazards we have by using that def param. In the chat window, I am putting that document here. Kindly download. Paste here. So guys, hopefully you will access this document. Everybody attending, you can click this link that has been shared in the chat window. From there, you download that document and go through the DevParam problems. Usage of Dev, if you use a DevParam keyword, what hazards are there, that you will find. Okay, let us proceed to another topic. Whether can someone acknowledge that document is accessible?
Yes, yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. This was the topic that we picked up before parameters. So everything, several things we've seen. Guys, are you able to recollect every discussion here we made about this one? Can someone acknowledge?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Let us go to this one. This is a very easy example. This very easy example. We have this 1, 2, 3, 4. There are 4 AND gates. Now, if you see this line 17, line 18, line 19, line number 19, line 20, we have 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 times we use the keyword AND. So without that also you can do it simply. And this entire thing here. And don't put a semicolon, separate with a comma. Now you put this entire thing here. Don't put a semicolon, comma. You put an entire thing here, comma, and then this one, entire thing here, and then terminate with this one. That way with one keyword also you can do very large, facilitate that provision. Similarly, line 14 and 15, you can do with only one NOT gate. So remember, as Dean said, this gate level, in industry, 1% I can put. 1% only. In industry, 1% only people possibly may look at this Verilog gate level. Because our designs are so complex, nobody will go to this one. 99% or 98% people go with a behavioral level modeling. This we yet to cover in subsequent classes, it will come. Behavioral level modeling. But we have to understand as a learner of this language that this Verilog has provision to make use of such gates and to describe such logic, this sort of logic at gate level. So what is the point that you may ask? The point here is, the problems, point here is for new learner, he or she will get acquaintance with the usage, Verilog compiler usage, compiler. You know, the tool that compiler that facilitates for you simulation and synthesis, that compiler, Verilog compiler usage. Getting acquaintance is a first thing. So later on, one can play. So that is one advantage for new learner, a sort of boost it will give. And instantly, if you have some smaller code, instantly, if you are familiar with this such gates availability in the language. So with that, you can instantly develop instead of going to the behavioral level. So, and the other one is, if you have behavioral level modeling here, this behavioral level, behavior level modeling needs to be converted to gate level. And then we have to this gate level simulation. Some tools are there. They perform simulation at the gate level. This gate level simulation. Some tools. So there is a variation in the simulation. If you perform at gate level, if you perform at behavioral levels, there is a simulation time gap. So some will take more time. Some will not take more time. So that simulation time differences are there. So you kindly Google which will take more time, and tomorrow you tell me. So whether behavioral level modeling takes more time for simulation time, description will take more time for simulation. That you Google and get answer tomorrow. So kindly tell me which is going to take. But the problem what I'm presenting here is the provision of this gate level, something this sort of advantage. Some will take more time, some will not take more time. So instantly guy is aware with this gate level, he or she can put a gate level and they can straight go to the simulation. Meaning this time, this conversion time they can avoid. What I'm trying to make the point here is behavioral to gate level, this conversion time, here there is a tool which converts behavioral code to gate level code. So this time, you know, this takes a time, right? So this time we can kill, we can avoid if you directly put here. But the problem is complex design is not possible. Complex design is not possible. So that's why we totally, as I said, 98 or 99% people will not, will use behavioral level only because of the complexity, huge complex designs. So that's, this is, if anyone, I think I'm assuming and going ahead because we had to wrap our sessions very quickly. So if you, I just wait for five count, I count five. If you have any queries about this description, you can ask me to describe. I'll describe. I mean, what I'm doing here in this code. If you don't have any queries, I assume that you don't have any queries. So our countdown starts with now. I count five. In between, you have to catch me. Like a stop, sir, and describe that. You have to tell. So our countdown starts now. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay, I assume everyone are familiar, no issues with everyone. So let us proceed. Let us skip this entire portion. So that's good. Now coming to this is what stimulus for multiplexer. This every step I want to discuss with everyone there. Those who are having familiar and those who are not familiar with everyone, I want to discuss because some important points are there. Those important points are this, you know, module, and you put a module name and you convert every input with a reg. That also you are familiar because earlier you have seen several. And every output keyword you will put a wire here in the test bench. That also you are familiar. Your module mux, this one mux 4_2_1, that one you are instantiating here. So that is also familiar. You are familiar with that. Now coming to this one here, you put the initial. It's a procedural construct, you know that also. In the test benches we mostly use begin, because this also you are familiar. If multiple statements are there, then we need a begin. Now set input lines here. You are setting IN, this all inputs you are setting here. You know, you are giving values to your inputs. This one something you have to look into. This one something you have to look into. What is the dollar display is doing here? What is the dollar display doing here? What is the dollar display doing here? And what is the dollar display doing here? This is something everyone must think about. Can I do away with that? That is another question that one must raise. Can I get away with that? Can I do without this? Answer is yes. If you use $monitor, and if you put all this inside here, over a simulation period, your simulation started with zero and going till, let us say, some 100 nanoseconds. So now, at every instant of time, whatever the variables that are there here is identified. If anything is finding a transition, change in that, everything is traced by this dollar monitor. What is dollar monitor? Dollar monitor is a system task. What is dollar display? It also system task. So then what is the difference? It executes only once. It executes whenever the variables that you are using inside here, any variable changing at corresponding time interval. So it is executed, this dollar monitor. So for that, what we are doing here is, this example from where I picked it, this one. They are using it once here because they are making some changes here. Now they are making some changes here and they want to see that one here. They are again updating this one, this dollar display. They are making some changes here. They are again using this dollar display. Throughout like that, some changes they are making and they are using that dollar display. They are making some changes, they are using a dollar display. You can avoid all these dollar displays usage here. All you can avoid here. With the help of only one, this dollar monitor, you put here before this end here, you put a dollar monitor. And you include inside every this all this what these people included here. The double quote, all these values, and include this one also, this one. I mean, only once if you include this is enough. Then you can avoid with all several such instances of dollar display. That is the one point that to the new learners I want to share with. The other is, you see this one here, slash n, it's for new line. So don't do this one here, this one. In the console window, in one line, you see every print here. All this will be printed, this one will be printed in only single line. After print of this one, you want to print them out in the new line. So at that time, you introduce this one, backslash, yeah, for new line. So that is the second observation that new learner must make. So I will share this PPT with everyone. You just copy and paste in your tool. Yesterday we demonstrated that EDA Playground tool. In that also you can try. Or Xilinx I ask you to install everyone. In that simulator also you can try. What you try? First this very code you try. This entire code you have it in your Xilinx. This is a design file. This entire is a test bench file. This entire is still here. This end module is a test bench. You have it. And the other time also, you create one more test bench in which you will be removing this dollar display. Everywhere dollar display is removed. Just before this end, you end this one. Here you put that dollar monitor, open the parentheses, double quote. Inside that, everything you put, everything means this everything. This B, you don't need to put this back, backslash N. After that, comma, you put a comma there. You see the comma everywhere here, people are keeping the comma there. Likewise, you put a comma there, and then you include this one. Enough. After that, what you do, you have to put this, as you see this one, you put here, this one here. After after double quotes, comma, this entire thing you put there. This entire thing you put here. After comma, this is comma. Again, then comma, one more comma, and then this entire thing. This entire thing. This entire thing. You put here. Now you see the impact. Same impact will be there. So what we understand from this, what is the conclusion that is drawn is, dollar display is a system task. Dollar monitor is also a system task, but this is executed only once. Currently, these are there, these values. This update will be shown here reflected. But these updates, if you are making, and this dollar display, if you are keeping at the end, every change here that is happening here, corresponding changes are not taken by this here everywhere. So that is the point that I'm trying to make. So that hopefully you people will try. If you have any queries, you can ask about this one. Now coming to 4-bit triple carry full adder. You have this 4-bit ripple carry adder. So basically we have, this is 1-bit full adder if you take. This is well known to everyone there. These Boolean expressions are known to everyone. So nothing much here to discuss here. With a new learner or already learned person, not required, it is digital logic. So with this digital information, that is Boolean expression, that knowledge, what we are going to build, this one. What is this 1-bit full adder? This also we have seen previously, several times we have seen this one. That this comprises one half adder. This is one half adder, and this comprises another half adder. This is half adder. And the mistake, you notice, anyone notice the mistake here? This should be a OR gate. So this gate is actually XOR gate. So that is a mistake in this. You must notice this one. What is the mistake that also you should notice? So this usage is not correct here. This should be OR gate. So you give your carry out. Where is the carry out coming here? The C1 here is going C1, right? And this is another C2. This would have been C2. This is another mistake, because generally we prefer S2 for some to C2. So give C1, C2 here. And give this OR gate out here to the C1. So the same is mapped to the verilog. Entire code is mapped to the verilog. Are there any explanation required here, the guys there who are seeing this code? I will run this sum, C out, A, B, C in. These are the primary inputs and primary outputs. So they are port list. In the port list, you know, only primary inputs, primary outputs will. And the type declaration, this is type declaration. And you have here wire here, this wire. If you don't mention wire, will there be any problem? Means answer is no. Answer is no. If you don't mention this wire, will there be any problem? Answer is no. Why? Why? Because these are scalar type. For scalar type, compiler is going to treat them like a wire only. If you don't mention also, compiler is going to treat them like a wire only. So for that reason, you don't need to mention this one wire here. If you are mentioning, that is well and good, but not required, because compiler is going to handle. But if they are vector type, it is compulsory. If they are vector type, compulsory you have to mention. Now this is self-explanatory, this entire code for you. So guys there, I count again, countdown point. If you have any queries about this, new learners can ask. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. All right, that's great. Now, you know this about ripple carry. Ripple carry, you know very well. So what is that? This is the first stage. And the sum has come, and the carry is going as a input to the next stage. And in the next stage, these inputs are given. And output is taken out. And this is, again, the carry in. And these are, you know very well, this one. So now what is the idea here is, we developed this 1-bit full adder code. This code, you know, this is your code, this module. This module we want to instantiate here. How many times? One, four times we want to instantiate, and we want to develop a code like this. This code you see here. We did not write any logic here for development of 4-bit full adder. Did you see any logic written here? Anybody seeing their new learner? Those who are familiar, no issues with that. But new learner, if you notice, we did not develop any logic here. We simply instantiated here this module, full adder. This full adder module here is already there, this one, full adder, this one. So you see this, let me take other color here. This full adder, this full add, you are actually instantiating here. This, you see the full add here and instantiating. That's it. There is no logic here. So what is the care taken is this sum, you see sum and C of and your A, B, C in. If you observe them carefully here, this out, if you observe carefully, it's a vector type here. This is a vector type. And the size is 4-bit. The size is 4-bit. So very obviously, if you see this one here, we need what we need? We need, this is 1, 2, 3, 4 bits we need. That's why with that idea, a vector has been taken with a size 4-bit. Now, if you see this one input here, A and B, these two, if you see A and B, and both are here, if you see this A through this B, we have, this is 1, this is 2, this is 3, this is the 4-bit. A is 4-bit, B is 4-bit. So with that idea, we have taken this A as a vector and B as a vector. That's the point. Now coming to this wire C1, C2, C3, the same story here. The C1, C2, C3 are they vector type or scalar type? They are scalar type. So we don't really need to put them here. Compiler is going to create them anyway. But as a learner, we have to practice that way to understand that that is taken care. Now what we are doing here is, first time when we instantiate, this is important. This sum, putting a sum in this place, C1 in its place, and A in its place, A, B in its place, C in its place, putting is important. This is called, already we have discussed it in previous videos, previous lectures, you can see. There are two types of binding. One is a positional binding or positional mapping. The other is named map. This in the previous videos, it is there. You can see, it's a named binding or named association or named mapping. So what do you think, new learners there? Is it a positional or named? It is a positional. Is a positional binding. Positional binding means we intend this sum to be binded with this one here. If you go here, this one, if you see this one here, this sum, we want to bind with that one. And we want to bind our carry out here with this. And we want to bind A of 0 with this and B of 0 with this, the C in with this. So this idea is there with us in our mind. So with that idea in mind, we are binding, we are placing them in its appropriate positions. That's why it is called positional binding. Otherwise, named binding is also there. That you see in the previous recorded videos. You will understand if you are not familiar with named mapping. So with that here, we completed our all instantiations 1, 2, 3, 4. So actually, this sort of description of a Verilog is called structural level modeling. Structural level modeling. So what you are doing, you are simply instantiating these structures, no? Are you writing any code? Means answer is no. This structure is instantiated. This is one structure. This is another structure. This is another. This is another. So you are taking care how to bind them here. How to bind them appropriately, this binding care you are taking. So that the binding care you have taken, how to appropriately bind them, and you are instantiating that structures. That's why such a description of this code is called structural level modeling. In this structural level modeling, this instantiation can be in any of the modeling level. That can be a switch level modeling, it can be gate level. It can be data flow level modeling, or it can be behavioral level modeling, or it itself can be a structural level. Are you getting the new learners there? What I'm trying? This modeling, you know, this entire modeling, this description, this entire description, this is now in which abstraction level you are using these gates? No, these gates. It is a gate level model. So I'm talking about this abstraction level. This abstraction itself could be a switch level. It could the way it is now in gate level. It could be in a behavioral level. It could be in a data flow level modeling, or it itself could be a structural level modeling. But the point here is this way of making here, this way of connecting the modules is called structural level modeling. This way of description is a structural level modeling. This also as a homework you can try. There are several homework. This is one homework. Earlier we gave this one def param is one of homework. This is another homework. Three homeworks are there with you now. You had to substitute this display with a dollar monitor. That is one homework. The first homework is the def param. So how harmful the def param keyword is, how dangerous it is. The document is shared. So tomorrow you have to talk about that. Somebody will be picked and somebody will be asked to speak out. So they have to speak out about def param. Be prepared for that. The other person will be asked about what is the response of this, how they felt after simulating using the dollar monitor. That is another exercise. The another third exercise is this one. This is one thing. Then you have to develop test bench for this, simulate new learners, and come to this one, new learners. Connect in this fashion, and there is a test bench here already. There is a test bench. You use this test bench, simulate and see the result. This is the third assignment. So there are three assignments given here. So hopefully you will accomplish. You will complete those assignments. So if there are any queries, I'll pick up the queries.